This video is sponsored by Magellan TV. Welcome back to Launchpad. I'm Christian Reddy, your friendly neighborhood astronomer. And today we're talking about fast radio bursts, or FRBs, or Furbies. These are powerful bursts of energy that were first discovered in 2007 and seem to be going off nearly every minute of every day. Most of these bursts are one-off events, but some of them repeat sporadically. They all seem to originate in galaxies that are millions, even billions of light years distant. So the fact that we can detect them at such high signal strength imply that they are extremely energetic events that can unleash the equivalent of half a billion suns in just a few milliseconds. But even though more than a decade had passed since they were discovered, there was no smoking gun observation of an actual FRB. Until now. In April 2020, a magnetar in our galaxy unleashed a powerful burst of X-rays and radio energy. This was our first detection of an FRB right here in our cosmic backyard. We'll talk about what FRBs are and why this observation is so important. But first, I'd like to thank Magellan TV, who are very kindly sponsoring today's video. If you've watched this channel before, you know that Magellan TV is a streaming service that brings together content in art, history, nature, and of course, space and science. I've been enjoying my subscription to Magellan TV, and I hope you have too. And if you'd like to give the gift of knowledge this holiday season, I'm excited to announce that Magellan is now offering a buy one, get one free gift card. If you go to the link in the description of this video, you'll be able to take advantage of this limited offer just for my YouTube viewers. Even better, purchasing a gift card will also give you an additional month of Magellan TV for free, even if you're already a member. So now is the time to try out Magellan TV and share it with not one, but two of your favorite curious people. And while you're there, make sure to check out The Amazing World of Gravity, hosted by Professor Jim Al-Khalidi. This two-part series tells the true story of gravity and brings fresh perspective into the way that Galileo, Newton, and Einstein revolutionized the study of our universe. Make sure to take advantage of this special offer by visiting the link in the description of this video. In 2007, astronomer Duncan Lorimer of West Virginia University was working on a survey of pulsars. Pulsars are rapidly rotating neutron stars that emit powerful beams of radiation from their magnetic poles. If the beams sweep along our line of sight, we detect them as pulsars. They're often referred to as cosmic lighthouses, but in this case, the rotating lamp is an ultra-dense core of a dead star the size of a city spinning hundreds or even thousands of times per second with a magnetic field capable of erasing all of the hard drives on Earth from the moon's distance, bringing about the end of civilization as we know it. Lorimer student David Narkovic was looking through archival data taken in 2001 by the Parkes radio telescope in Australia. He noticed a powerful burst of radio energy that was so bright it saturated the Parkes antenna. The burst itself lasted all of 5 milliseconds and was gone, never to be seen again. But its signal did not arrive all at once. Instead, the highest frequency waves arrived first, while the lower frequencies were delayed. This is an effect called dispersion, and it's the reason light spreads out according to its wavelength, or frequency, when it passes through a medium such as a prism or droplets of water. But there's another effect of dispersion that's less obvious. Not only is light separated into its component frequencies, but light at lower frequencies moves slower than light at higher frequencies. Now, you may be wondering how that's possible, since light is supposed to travel at 300 million meters per second. Well, it is true that light will move at that speed, but only if it's moving in a vacuum. In a medium, it slows down according to its frequency. The lower the frequency, the slower it moves. Oh, and by the way, space is not a vacuum. Sure, on small distance scales, yes, it certainly can be a vacuum. But on interstellar and intergalactic scales, space is filled with all kinds of stuff, especially free electrons. When light travels over cosmological distances, the occasional encounter with an electron will start to add up in a big way. By the time radio light arrives at Earth, dispersion sweeps the frequencies over hundreds of milliseconds. The longer the radio waves have to travel, the greater the dispersion. So, by measuring the sweep of the dispersion, or the delay between the highest and the lowest frequencies, you can work out how far away the source was. And in this case, the burst had to be coming from outside of our galaxy, up to a gigaparsec, or 3 billion light years away. The fact that such a strong signal arrived from so far away meant that the burst had to unleash something like 500 million suns worth of energy in just 5 milliseconds. For several years, the Lorimer burst, as it came to be known, remained the only known signal of its kind. Then in 2013, another team reported 4 more FRB detections in Park's archival data. Now, even though only a handful of FRBs had been discovered, it was already very clear that these had to be going off everywhere all the time in order to just be picked up by accident. Estimates ranged around 2,500 to as many as 10,000 bursts a day. That's more than one burst every minute. At first, it wasn't clear just what these bursts were, but after years of investigation, astronomers were finally able to rule out microwave ovens. In 2010, astronomers at Parkes began noticing what looked like FRBs at first, but they were kind of clumpy and seemed to radiate at some frequencies longer than others. These weird bursts were named Perytons, after the mythological creature created by Argentine short story writer Jorge Luis Borges. I know, right? That Jorge Luis Borges! I'm so ignorant of Argentinian fantasy. The Perytons had all the markings of a terrestrial signal, but because they appeared similar to FRBs, they also raised questions as to whether or not FRBs were real astronomical phenomena or just another kind of Periton. Eventually, astronomers at Parkes noticed that most of the Perytons were detected when the antenna was pointed in the general direction of the visitor's residence, and that most of the Periton events occurred at lunchtime. It turns out that astronomers were opening the microwave oven before it finished heating up their lunch. If the oven is open while it's still running, microwaves escape, and the frequency decreases as the magnetron turns off. The results were even published in the monthly notices of the Royal Astronomical Society. Science for the win. But in its own way, the Periton result lent more credence to fast radio bursts because, unlike Perytons, FRBs occurred at all times of the day, regardless of where the telescope was pointed. So, fast radio bursts really were an astronomical phenomena that needed investigation. The problem was, nobody knew just what these things were. Several ideas started popping up in the literature, including a new kind of supernova, or colliding neutron stars, or neutron stars falling into black holes, or comets and asteroids slamming into neutron stars, or even exotic ideas such as primordial black holes exploding back out as white holes, or kinks in superconducting cosmic strings. There was even a proposal that FRBs were the light beams of alien civilizations to propel sailcraft. Guess which explanation the New York Post decided to go with? Meanwhile, astronomers tried to detect FRBs with other telescopes, preferably those without microwave ovens nearby. And in 2012, a team detected an FRB at the Arecibo Radio Observatory in Puerto Rico. Arecibo is the second largest radio dish in the world, or at least it was before the accident. We'll talk about that later, or else I'll start crying. Not only was the first FRB detected outside of Parkes, but many months later, Arecibo detected 10 more bursts coming from the same source in a single day. Arecibo had found the first FRB repeater. Some of the bursts were very bright, others were weak, some brighter in some frequencies but not in others, and it was all just very weird and surprising. But Arecibo showed that FRBs can and do repeat, which in turn meant that FRBs aren't necessarily things that would destroy its source, like a supernova or neutron stars colliding or collapsing into black holes. The reason it took Arecibo to find the repeating bursts is because of its large aperture. Radio waves are very long, on the order of centimeters or even meters. The longer the wavelength, the larger the telescope has to be to resolve the source. So even though Parkes is a 64-meter antenna, its angular resolution is so low it can only localize the source to a general direction in the sky, which could contain up to thousands of galaxies. With a 300-meter dish, Arecibo gets significantly better resolution, so it can narrow down where in the sky the source is coming from. But to really pinpoint the source, you need to use an interferometer of radio telescopes, like the Very Large Array in New Mexico. In 2016, VLA started hunting for the source. The two circles in this diagram represent two locations Arecibo was pointed at when the bursts occurred, so they knew that the source had to be somewhere in the overlap between the two. After several months of scanning this region with VLA, the burst repeated again and the source was pinpointed. Now that they had a precise location for the burst, astronomers could finally use the 8-meter Gemini telescope to see what kind of galaxy it was coming from. You might think that something capable of unleashing that much energy would have to come from a big galaxy with lots of massive stars, black holes, and all sorts of things that could go boom in the night. But Gemini instead found a tiny dwarf galaxy. Now, they were able to use this galaxy's redshift to estimate its distance, which worked out to about 3 billion light years. So this was confirmation that FRBs originate at cosmological distances. But like anything else in astronomy, answering one question raised new ones. Like, do FRBs repeat? Are they all at cosmological distances? And are they only a thing in dwarf galaxies, or can they happen in larger ones? To answer those questions, a lot more FRBs would need to be found, but FRBs are transient events that could go off anywhere in the sky at any time. There needed to be a way of scanning a large region of the sky at once, yet still be able to pinpoint an FRB's position. Luckily, a new kind of radio telescope called the Canadian Hydrogen Intensity Mapping Experiment, or CHIME, was designed to do just that. It's located at the Dominion Radio Astrophysical Observatory in Penticton, British Columbia. It was built to map out the location of molecular hydrogen over a good chunk of the observable universe, but it turned out to be an ideal FRB hunter. Unlike a conventional telescope, CHIME has no moving parts. It doesn't even have an ordinary radio dish. Instead, it uses an array of four 100-meter cylinders. The cylinders focus radio waves to 256 antennas running down the center of each pipe. Each pipe is fixed in place, so CHIME doesn't steer like an ordinary radio dish. Instead, it scans a long rectangle of the sky stretching from north to south. Since Earth rotates, CHIME sees essentially the entire northern sky every 24 hours. Any FRBs that go off in its field of view are detected. In fact, CHIME detected 13 new FRBs while it was still being commissioned in 2018. Among them was a second repeating source. In 2019, CHIME detected 8 new repeating FRBs. Then 9 more repeaters were announced in March 2020. Now keep in mind, those are just the repeating sources. CHIME has detected hundreds of FRBs to date, and it's still got that new radio telescope smell. But all of the FRBs had one thing in common. They were all detected from beyond our galaxy, which means they must be extremely energetic phenomena. But that finally changed in April 2020 when CHIME detected a bright radio burst coming from the Magnetar SGR1935+2154. Magnetars are ultra-magnetized neutron stars. Their magnetic fields are around 1,000 times stronger than a typical neutron star, and 10 trillion times stronger than a refrigerator magnet. That's strong enough to rip molecules apart from thousands of kilometers away, and even distort individual protons that wander too close. That means a flabbergasting amount of energy is stored up in the magnetar's magnetic field. On April 27, SGR-1935 generated a storm of X-ray outbursts over several hours. It was detected by NASA's Swift satellite, the Fermi Gamma Ray Observatory, and the NICER instrument on the International Space Station. During the storm, NICER recorded more than 200 X-ray bursts in just 20 minutes. 13 hours later, SGR-1935 underwent a second outburst. But this second outburst had a powerful radio component as well. The radio burst was picked up by CHIME and by Caltech's Survey for Transient Astronomical Radio Emission 2, or STARE 2, detector. So this was the first ever bona fide fast radio burst detected in our galaxy, and we got the X-ray data as well. But what exactly about the outburst caused the FRB? One possible mechanism is that the magnetar produced a super short flare that lasted less than a millisecond. The particles unleashed in the flare collided with particles that had been emitted from the previous flares during the storm. The collision generates an outward moving shock front, which in turn produces strong magnetic fields. Electrons gyrate around the magnetic field lines and emit a burst of radio waves. The shock wave also heats up the electrons, which then causes them to emit X-rays. Based on its distance and observed energy, SGR 1935 seems like a less energetic version of the FRBs that we see in other galaxies. And that makes sense because we should only be able to detect the strongest FRBs in distant galaxies. But this leaves open the question, are FRBs just magnetars undergoing some kind of cataclysm, or are they really something even more powerful? Well, I think the answer is probably going to be both. I wouldn't be surprised if FRBs are subclassified or given entirely different names depending on what they turn out to be. But man, what an exciting time to be picking up new signals in the universe. Now, if you'd like to learn more about neutron stars, pulsars, and magnetars, I made a video about them that you'll want to check out. And NASA created the first ever map of a pulsar, only to find it doesn't actually look like what we thought it should. So I'll see you over there in those videos when we're done here. My thanks to my Patreon supporters for keeping Launchpad Astronomy going, and I'd like to welcome Ken Alper, and thanks as well to Anna for her intergalactic level support, and Michael Dowling, Stephen J. Morgan, and Morrison Wild for the cosmological level support. If you'd like to support Launchpad for the price of a cup of coffee every month, well, please head on over to my Patreon page. And if you'd like to join me on this journey through this incredible universe of ours, well, please make sure you subscribe and ring that notification bell so that you don't miss out on any new videos. Until next time, stay home, stay healthy, and stay curious, my friends.